continue with a short introduction to EUDOT and the EUDOT services. So thanks to Christine for providing the slides. Most of you, I guess, will know the EUDOT project, so we won't be saying too much about the project itself. But the goals or the objectives of the EUDOT project are to implement and develop, welcome Mark, to develop and implement an integrated, cost-effective and sustainable pan-European solution for sharing, preserving and accessing research data. In this context, it's important that the EUDOT project supports the open access policy to research data. So if possible, all data deposited within EUDOT should be open. Of course, there are can be some exceptions where not all information is open, but we really advocate open access. The EUDOT project is looking at interoperability between existing European e-infrastructures. There's a collaboration with the Research Data Alliance, RDA. I think several members of the EUDOT project have been member of EUDOT, RDA interest groups and RDA working groups. And of course, probably one of, at least in my opinion, the most important objective is engagement of the research communities. Developing such a infrastructure is good and needed, but getting the research communities on board and using the infrastructure is as important as developing the infrastructure. So if you look at the EUDOT project, it's really spread across the whole of Europe. It's a consortium of several high-performance computing centers, several data centers, libraries, scientific communities, many data scientists. And if you look at all the members, I think it's over 30 members across Europe. Clarien is a member. Sara is a member of EUDOT. But that's all the data centers. Of course, as I said, the communities are also important. They are the users of the infrastructure. So the data centers provide the services, and the communities are making use of those services. And they are spread over 5 different domains. And I think it's also over 20 or 25 communities which are currently participating and using EUDOT services.
Sorry. In the network, in the previous slide, there is one dot in Vienna as well, as far as I can see. But there would yes. be a computing center in which one would it be?
That's a good question.
Because I know we have some partners there as a community, but I thought there were not a Viennese center that would.
The Umwelt Bundesamt was from Austria.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
But okay, then the dots are not all data centers, but I think the Umwelt Bundesamt was one of the community centers.
Yeah, okay.
But some community centers, I think they were one of the core communities in the first EUDOT project. I think the core communities are also marked in this network. But it's a good question. I will ask our guys from production if maybe there's an Austrian data center.
As far as I know, the nearest we have is the one in
Munich. It's RSIG. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it would be interesting for you if there would be an Austrian data center. Obviously. Yeah. So that's a good point. I will check if we have one, but probably you're right that we don't. So who can use the EUDOT services? Of course, it's the single researchers. I think that's an important group. If you're a researcher and you are not part of a group or a community that has the resources to provide a repository or provide the services you need, you should be able to use the services offered by EUDOT. The same goes for teams. And for both the single researchers and the teams, the focus is on using EUDOT, as I will explain in the following slides. Another group of users are entire communities, and communities can also be consist of multiple parts. For example, Clarien is one community, but there are many Clarien centers. And communities can either use the EUDOT services as they are, or they can join EUDOT and get some more customization, some more integration at some cost. So there are some different strategies for the different usage scenarios, which we will discuss next. So one of the usage scenarios is using the EUDOT Collaborative Data Infrastructure, CDI, via APIs. So you have a community center or a repository, and they implement community-specific policies. And what is really important in this scenario is that, basically in all scenarios, I think, is that the community center remains the main actor for community data stewardship. So they should remain owner of the data and should remain responsible for the data. And if you look at the EUDOT CDI, we have different EUDOT data centers, and the community or the community center, there can be more, they interact with different EUDOT nodes, different EUDOT data centers offering services to the community. What is important here is that by using the EUDOT collaborative data infrastructure in this way, that you're using standardized APIs and web services, and that the EUDOT CDI can be seen as some sort of a cloud that you can interact with, but you don't become part of this cloud. And most of the responsibilities for your data management and your data organization, they all remain on the community side, on the side of your community data center. And you are also responsible for compliance with all your policies, but also the EUDOT policies. Another use case is, sorry, I should mention this with the previous slide. If you use the EUDOT collaborative data infrastructure using the APIs and not on ingest node, as we will explain in the next slide, you can communicate basically with any EUDOT data center, any EUDOT service, that doesn't really matter. There is an alternative way of using the collaborative data infrastructure, and that's by using a data ingest node. And this is a little bit of a more tight integration with the EUDOT CDI, since this basically implies that some of the responsibilities from your community center are placed at this EUDOT ingest node. I think a good example could be generation of PIDs. So if you have a community center and you have some data, but you don't have a PID server, you don't have the resources to run a PID server, you could use such an EUDOT ingest node, which means that if you ingest data from your repository into the EUDOT ingest node, you're still using the CDI, but this ingest node can take over the responsibilities for running the PID server and assigning the PIDs for you. But this creates some more complexity in the distribution of responsibilities, since some of the responsibilities of managing and maintaining your data will be on the community sides, but some of those responsibility will be at the EUDOT ingest node, so you have to make agreements about this. But I think still the aim of this approach is easy integration with little effort, or as little effort as possible on the community side, in running additional services and making it as easy as possible to ingest your data into the EUDOT data infrastructure. And the last use case, it's what we call joining the CDI, is really making your community center part of the EUDOT collaborative data infrastructure. This brings some advantages, such as better integration with other EUDOT data centers, so you can more easily replicate your data across multiple locations, for example, within the EUDOT infrastructure. But it also comes with some additional responsibilities, since you have to install and conform to the software stack that's required for the EUDOT CDI, which in the case of B2Safe means that you have to install IROTS and maintain IROTS and keep the B2Safe middleware, which is a plugin in the IROTS installation. You have to maintain all these components and keep them up to date. And also you have to adhere to some common policies from the EURAT infrastructure, such as support for persistent identifiers, proper metadata handling, proper security. You will need to have a security officer on site. There should be proper monitoring. So this really requires some effort on the side of the community center. And that's also the reason why in this tutorial we will be, in this workshop today, we will be more focusing on the using the CDI scenarios and not so much on joining.
So what's metadata handling in Excel? To use the same standard?
There are some requirements that each digital object in the EURAT domain, that each digital object has a resource and a metadata file. So in order to become join the CDI as a community center, you need to have metadata for all your digital objects, for example. I think that's the requirement which is meant here.
Certain format.
Not to save it is a certain format and certain information that needs to be stored together with the data files. So we to save will take care of it, but it's then up to the community to keep this data up to date.
But I think the required metadata is quite basic.
Yeah, it is quite basic, but it might be extended in the next.
Yeah.
There's a question.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
So if we already have persistent identifiers in DataCite, there is also the metadata there. Is that supported?
Yes. Yes, that is supported. That's a common use case. Some communities, they do run their own PID server, or they use their own PID system and they assign PIDs. And I think Christine will probably say a little bit more about it, but within the EURAT infrastructure, the replicas are managed by EURAT internal persistent identifiers. So if you have your own persistent identifiers, that's disconnected from the persistent identifiers used within the EURAT domain. And in the case where you don't have persistent identifiers at your community center, and you will ingest data into EURAT, you will just use the first the PID minted by the data ingest node in the EURAT CDI as the persistent identifier for a digital object.
We'll come to this, it's an exercise in the
tutorial. But both scenarios are supported. So the last part of this session is about the different services that EURAT offers, and to some extent the interoperability between the services. And for each service, we will briefly discuss if you can use them or join them, and if you can do both, what it means. So there's five main services: B2Drop, B2Share, B2Save, B2Stage, and B2Find. Those are all the services here. They are all making use of PIDs and AAI, which is the sixth service that we will briefly discuss. And there's the B2Find service, which enables you to search all the research data. So if we briefly go over each of the services, we have B2Drop, which is basically some sort of Dropbox alternative offered by EURAT. It focuses on secure and trusted data exchange. There's a desktop client, so you can synchronize data on your desktop with the B2Drop service automatically. It supports versioning of data that's stored into B2Drop. There's a web interface, and you can mount your B2Drop account via WebDAV. This service is in production, so if you're interested, you can start using it today if you go to b2drop.eurat.eu. The typical usage scenario for B2Drop is making use of this service. EURAT runs this service, and as a researcher, a team, or a community, you can sign up and deposit your data in B2Drop and share it with colleagues.
Where is it based on?
The underlying technology is on cloud.
And who is entitled for using it? Anybody? Or researcher? Or how is it?
All researchers are entitled to use it. Do you know the basic storage that you get?
20 gigabytes.
20 gigabytes is the amount of storage that you get for free. So there's another service, B2Share, and where B2Drop is focused on the easy depositing of data and sharing. B2Share is more focused on preserving the data that you deposit, so that has some consequences. Also, the data that you deposit within B2Share can be shared with others. Of course, the main policy for data deposited in B2Share is that all data should be open. There are some exceptions, so you can close data, but we prefer open data. All data that you publish in B2Share will be assigned a persistent identifier automatically, and in that sense can be published very easily. Also, B2Share is running in production and it's integrated with B2Access that we will discuss last, which is the EU.ai service. So if you go to b2share.eu.eu, you can sign up for B2Share, and if your home IDP is part of, I think, Edugain, then there should be a good chance that you are able to use your home organization account to use B2Share. Of course, since most of you will be aware of all the difficulties with Edugain opt-in, not all IDPs might have accepted the B2Share service provider, so there could be issues. Please let us know if you encounter those IDPs. B2Share is also, you can also use B2Share as a community. So EU that again will offer the service. I think I've also heard the possibility of deploying B2Share instance with your community, but I'm not fully sure about this. That is possible. So that would be more of the joining.
Yeah.
So it is possible as a community, if you're interested in getting a branded B2Share installation, to install it yourself and basically join the EU.cdr in that sense. So B2Share is more of a generic repository for data publishing, aimed at communities which are unable to run their own repository. The metadata which is deposited and required for all data objects is always publicly accessible. The data objects themselves can be closed. It's currently aimed at the long tail data. There's a nice web interface and a REST interface. And there are some basic search functionality in the B2Share service to search metadata.
One thing about the metadata, so the user account, the email address and the name of the user is also part of the metadata and will be published. So
that's a good point.
It's a publishing platform. It's not something like this own cloud instance where you can have dedicated data exchange with colleagues. You can think of it like the archive.org server for publishing preprints.
Yeah, and the search functionality offered by B2Share is quite basic, but as we will see later on, it's integrated with B2Find to improve these search capabilities. So moving on to B2Find, which is the EU.metadata catalog for research data. So it's yet another metadata harvesting portal. All EU.internal metadata is harvested together with metadata harvested from external providers via the OAI PMH protocol. I think the underlying technology is CCAN, yes, and I forgot to mention this for B2Share, that's Invenio. All the metadata which is ingested into, sorry, there's a question.
From data side, is the metadata harvested only the records which actually have data in EUNet, or is it only a subset of data site?
I think that's a good question. I think is there data site information? I think
that
OAI provider
sure
is
no. Full data site or just for the communities using
It's an interesting question.
Because I saw the numbers and it was quite a lot lower than the whole of data set.
Okay, it's a good question to see why.
Yeah, you can't get you can't get a connection to B2Find.
Okay, that's also interesting.
Yeah. I can get Maybe on the wired internet you can get a
connection to I can try. But anyway, all data ingested into B2Find is browsable and searchable through standardized facets. So this implies that for all metadata schemas, there has to be some mapping to a set of facets. It's also possible to access the scientific data objects. All data that's ingested must have metadata. So this metadata is used to get a reference to the data object and provide a link to access the reference metadata, the reference data object, which not necessarily is accessible. You might need to have an account to log in. Also, this service is running in production. Maybe it's not accessible over Eduroam. That's something we can test today.
You can. Access B2Find, yeah.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay, so it's not Eduroam related. And I think we also have some Clarin metadata in there. I think our some Clarin centers are harvested.
So good. The idea is to have them all in the end. I think since the number of metadata records we are providing is quite high, I think they're still looking into ways of.
Yeah, I don't think the B2Find is harvesting the full VLO.
Not yet.
No. Is it on a center per center basis now, or do you know?
I think it's an arbitrary selection of centers.
Okay. Now that's something that we can improve. But I think there are also some performance limitations on the underlying Seqan software, which is one of the reasons why not the full VLO is used. Again, you can both join or use B2Find. Using just means using the instance provided by EUDAT. But EUDAT also offers the B2Find service to install for your community, which also means that installation should be harvested by the EUDAT B2Find as well. So if you host a B2Find for your repository, the EUDAT B2Find instance should harvest that metadata as well. Now, this is also a good example of some integration between two EUDAT services. So we have B2Share, where you can deposit data with metadata. And B2Share out of the box provides this OAI PMH endpoint. So B2Find is configured to harvest all the metadata provided via B2Share. So as soon as you deposit data in B2Share, it will be browsable and findable via B2Find, and by linking to the underlying resources, if you find this interesting collection in B2Find, you can link back to the data object which is hosted in B2Share. And next to B2Share, as we already discussed, there's a number of community metadata stores that are harvested as well.
And sorry, what is the metadata format there? Given in the back of my mind, the complex Clarin CMDI framework for metadata. So, do you just take the Dublin core, or is there some mapping involved?
It's Dublin core since.
Yeah, but there's some mapping involved per community metadata store, or in this case B2Share. So there's a mapping from the metadata which is provided by B2Share to the facets in B2Find. So that also means if there's a new community that's integrated into B2Find with a new metadata schema, a new metadata format, a new mapping has to be created. Then the next service is B2Save, which is the most interesting for in the context of today as well. B2Save focuses in providing an abstraction layer to virtualize large-scale data resources. You can use this to replicate your data from your repository into B2Save in order to archive this data and preserve the data for the long term. A long time outstanding goal is to optimize access to this replicated data. Now that the B2Access service is actually in production, getting this access to resources distributed in B2Save is quite high on the priority list, but it's not implemented yet. Another use case of B2Save is also that if you ingest your data from your repository center into B2Save, you can use the EUDOT infrastructure and the B2Save service to move your data close to, for example, high performance compute centers if you need to do some analysis on your data. You can join EUDOT by using B2Save, or you can use EUDOT by you can use B2Save. Using B2Save will be the focus of today's workshop. It will focus on using the I commands and grid FTP. Both will be explained in more detail, and especially for B2Save, if you want to join EUDOT, this really requires some effort from the community center. Some of the features of B2Save is that there's an auditable data policy rule. It makes use of persistent identifiers. There's this data policy manager, which is a central service that you can use to define and configure and manage your replication data replication policies, and use those policies to configure how the replication should work. Should it go from A to B to C, or do you want A to B and A to C at the same time? There's some support for repository packages. One of those, the DSpace package, will be presented by Joseph today. The basis for this DSpace repository package has been developed by the people at Charles University. And there's ongoing work on a lightweight HTTP-based interface. We would have liked to be able to present that today, since I think it would be really useful, but it's still under development, so it's not there yet. Another EUDOT service is B2Stage, which is somewhat similar to, it's related to B2Save, but where B2Save is focused at storing data and moving data within the EUDOT infrastructure, B2Stage is focused at high performance transfers from EUDOT data nodes to high performance compute nodes. Plus the interface provided by B2Stage can also be used for ingestion of data into B2Save, and that's the grid FTP interface that we will be discussing today. And this is a service you can only use. The last service I want to discuss in this overview is B2Access. This has gone into production in end of October, and it basically is the EUDOT solution for federated authentication and authorization. There's support for many different technologies to authenticate. You can authenticate using SAML, using your home organization, so that's probably well known within the Clarin context. B2Access is part of Edugain. You can authenticate using some social identities. Currently we support Google accounts. We are investigating Facebook accounts as well. It's also possible, if none of those options are suitable for you, to create an account with B2Access directly. So B2Access will be some kind of homeless identity provider in that sense. Within B2Access, you will be assigned to groups related to all the EUDOT services. And depending on what kind of group membership you have, you will have certain permissions with EUDOT services. By default, you will have read-only access in all the EUDOT services.
Small remark here, so it's good to realize that B2Access will also be connected to both the Clarin Service Provider Federation and the Clarin Identity Provider. In fact, the Clarin Identity Provider connection has been made already.
Yeah, that's a good point.
The SPF is on the way, so that means that all Clarin users will also have access to all of the Clarin, to all of the EUDOT services that are available through B2Access. So think of B2Drop, B2Share, that will all be connected to the Clarin ways of logging.
Yeah. And yeah, the integration with B2Save is also high on the to-do list. So as soon as that's finished, you can use your Clarin identity to authenticate to B2Save as well. So that was basically, you can use B2Access. EUDOT offers this service. We are investigating other scenarios of maybe joining B2Access where you either host the software yourself or not, but that's still under discussion. So this was a really brief overview of all the EU.dot services, the EU.dot infrastructure, and important for this workshop today, the difference between using and joining the CDI. So are there any questions so far?
Maybe I missed that, but is there a connection from B to drop to B to share? So can you access your B to drop storage?
You didn't miss that. No, the connection is not there. And I think the main reason is that B2Share requires your digital object to have proper metadata, while this requirement is not there for B2Drop. So B2Drop is really focused at quickly sharing data with others, while B2Share is really focused on publishing, depositing and publishing your data.
Imagine that you get your data from B2Drop and then add the metadata such that you want to.
So they are working on this currently.
Yeah.
We have a developer at SoftServer who's working on this integration.
It's a good example of another use case where our services work together. Yeah. So I guess we can continue with Christine with the IROTS introduction.